Yo!
What's up? This is Patrick.
And I'm Phil.
And Phil, you and I have been talking about lots of lake houses. I mean, we've been writing Python. We've been chatting about this. We started talking about Direct Lake. Everybody wants to use Direct Lake. But with this new, you know, storage mode that's available in these lake houses and all these parquet files and V-ordering, we need to make sure that some things are intact before we go down that road. So you've created something that'll help us with that. Tell us about it.
Yeah, there's a lot going on with the Delta tables, and everyone wants to make sure everything is running as fast as possible. And the data, the way it gets organized in Delta tables, can have a big influence on a couple of areas of performance. There's how long does it take data to get paged into the model, query speed, all that. And what I've done is I've put together a script to help you do some diagnostics, to help you look at your Delta tables, just to give you a few clues about perhaps some things that you might be able to do to help make your models run faster, because at the end of the day, that's what we want. Use less compute as well, so save you money in the long term.
So enough of all this talking. You all know what we like to do. Let's do what? Let's head over to my laptop. What you would do is you go to aka.ms Delta Analyzer, and it'll bring you to the Git repo, and you click right here and you can download the zip file. Once you download the zip file, you extract it out, you'll see that there is a notebook in that extraction. And so what you want to do, go to a workspace that's over in Fabric, click on new, and then down here you can choose import.
I believe that only might show up if you've got your data engineering profile turned on. So in that situation, just jump to the home button, and on the base screen there will be an option to import notebook, because this Delta Analyzer is just a Fabric notebook.
So I'm going to go ahead and import this. Adam struggles with this a little bit. Choose upload, Delta Analyzer. So I'm going to get this uploaded. There it goes right there. I'm going to go ahead and open it up. And something to call out is that whenever you connect to this notebook, it appears that it's connected to the last lake house that it was connected to. So I'm going to remove all these lake houses, and then I'm going to connect to the lake house that I want to analyze. Right now, I brought it into the workspace where my lake house exists, but this notebook can live anywhere because you can connect to different lake houses. And so how do I get started with this, Phil? Tell me about this.
Well, a couple of quick things I like to do to just simplify it is see at line two, you can actually hover and collapse sections of notebook code. All so you can collapse that imports, and even it reminds you with a bit of text there says collapse me. And on the instructions, maybe perhaps collapse those because you've read them. Jump down to line 70 there. There's another little carrot that you can collapse. There's quite a bit of code there for you to look through later on if you want to. But otherwise, all we're really interested in are these parameters. Now, the most important parameter is that one at line 60 saying, what is the name of the Delta table in your lake house that you want to run this analytics over?
Let me analyze my calendar table. So just make sure I understand. We only can do one table at a time here.
Yeah, but this gives you the bare bones that you could customize. So there's nothing stopping you creating an iterator, a for each loop, and running this not only over all of the tables in perhaps that lake house, but running it over multiple lake houses as well. So what's important here is it gives you the code that inspects the metadata and extracts the information that we care about and presents it on the screen or saves it to some tables, as you'll see.
So now I'm going to choose this, and there's some other parameters here. Why don't you tell us about these other parameters?
At line 64 is just whether you want to just overwrite the findings that you had from the last time you ran this, because you might want to append this and accumulate this data over time, especially if you're diagnosing and making quick fire changes. Print to screen, just whether you want to display the output directly underneath this code cell when you run it. Skip cardinality. There is a little bit of code, which will, like VertiPack Analyzer, analyze every single column in the table to tell you how many unique values. Now, this is important, especially for very large tables, but it can take time, so you can switch that off if you don't care about that for a given run. Skipping writing to tables. Now, if you want to persist this data and run it over several iterations and over different tables, well, then what it will do is it'll create some tables in your lakehouse and append to them or overwrite them so that you can start running SQL or create Power BI reports to do some admin and governance. In this case, we're going to set it. We do want to create it. That last parameter just tells the format some of the data with commas in the right place or decimal points, etc. But the main parameter is that top one. What is the table that we want to analyze? And once you've done that and you hit the run button, everything's self-contained in this one code cell. There are no dependencies. It will go and look at the metadata, not the actual data contained in the Delta table that you want to analyze, and tell you all sorts of interesting things. How many parquet files are there? How many row groups inside each parquet file? How's the data organized?
So I'm going to go ahead and run this. By default, it was set to true. I'm changing this to false because I do want to write to tables. Okay, I want to persist this information that we're about to run. So I'm going to run this, and then there is an option right here. I don't want this to auto resize. My session started up, took 5 seconds. I love how fast these Spark sessions start in Fabric.
Notice your lake house on the left-hand side has seven tables. because of the parameter you've set, it's going to generate four new tables. Each table Delta Analyzer generates can be deleted. It's really just there to capture something that you can come back to and run some SQL query or Python or even Power BI over. Now, each of the four tables focuses on a different area of the information in the Delta table. The top level table will tell you how many Parquet files are there. So in very, very large tables, this can be in the hundreds. The second table will actually look inside the row groups for each table. The third one will even look at columns inside row groups. So it gets quite detailed. And then the final table will give you details about individual columns, cardinality, data types, useful things like that.
If I go down to this last one, I was looking at this. This is eerily familiar to VertiPack Analyzer, right? If I turn on this property up here, Phil, with the cardinality, mm-hmm. I'm assuming that some of these additional columns will be populated with some information right here.
I think if your table's small enough, because we can tell from the metadata how big the table is, we just run the cardinality check. If it's such a fine table, it's not going to impact. Where we want to be careful is if you have a 10 billion row table, that cardinality check might take, you know, quite a bit of time depending on the capacity.
I'm happy you said that.
Over on the left-hand side, you'll see a whole bunch of tables have been created by Delta Analyzer.
Yep.
They all start with ZZ underscore. These allow you to accumulate this data and do analytics over time. You can run SQL over.
So that was a small table, but I want to run this over a big table so we really can see what this thing can do, because I mean, this is a little baby table with only 5,000 rows in it. I'm going to run this over a table that I know have lots and lots of data in it, okay? Because I want to make sure it's V-ordered and it's properly laying out the files for me and things like that. So I'm going to run this over fat cab rights. Let's run this.
It's a big table.
And now, because I set this to overwrite, it's actually going to delete the data from the previous run.
That's right. And also at the very top, is it provides just a little output called SuperSummary. I've called it SuperSummary. Mm-hmm. It just gives you that quick fire info, like does the table have V-order? And that's a really important thing you want to make sure your Delta tables have if you want your performance to be really, really good. But then the other information can also be useful, because the more Parquet files, the more row groups, the fewer rows, you get a lot more I.O. And there's two critical areas we care about with direct lake over Delta tables. One is how long does it take to page data into memory? And the second area is query speed. So you can adjust things in the makeup of the data in your Delta table that can impact both.
So we go back over, we'll notice that there are 70 Parquet files with this particular table, and it skipped that cardinality check. I'm assuming because there's a billion rows in this, and if we had that cardinality check on, it would take a long time to run through this process. We got 1.1 billion rows.
A decent sized table. And actually the notebook code allows you to actually create charts off these outputs. You can do some pretty interesting and neat things here in the fabric notebook experience with that display. We can see the order's turned on, and that's confirmed here in the top output. We can see how many rows are contained within each Parquet file, for example, how many row groups. Now, row groups map one-to-one with segments inside AE, so that can be a helpful piece of information. And we're also looking at generally the number of rows per row group, and that's why in the summary at the top, I'm sort of displaying what is the average number of rows. Now, a sweet spot we find is anywhere from sort of 10 to 50 million rows per row group on average. If you have too few rows per row group in a large table, when it comes time to page that data in, it's going to use a lot more I.O. and potentially fall back to the SQL endpoint or direct query if you have that property turned on.
And so when I scroll down though, I'm really liking this table a lot right here, this Delta table columns. And now you can see we don't have the values here because we had that cardinality check turned off. But I can go and look, if I turn it on, I can see what the cardinality is, the column size, you know, what's taking up space in my model. Very similar to what I see with DAX Studio. It's really nice. So I'm going to do one more thing, Phil. I'm doing some testing comparing tables that are V-ordered and tables that are not V-ordered. I use the exact same Parquet files, the exact same data, and I created another managed table without V-order. I intentionally did this. You probably shouldn't do this, but I want you to give me some advice when I'm not using V-order. So let me show you what I did. So I'm going to go over here and I have this table called no V-order because I want to do some testing. I'm doing some testing. I'm kicking the tires on Fabric. Let's run this. Remember we had 70 files. Now we have 361 files because I didn't write optimize my tables. And then you see this dot. It's going to take so much longer because it's so much more files that it's got to iterate over and produce this information for me. But I think this is a good example of when things go wrong, when you have an ugly baby.
And if you had the parameter set to append, the second run, you could actually do some analytics and do much more of a deep dive about what did change or what is different between these two tables, for example.
Yeah. Look at that. I forgot what it was before, but it was definitely not that big. And it's much smaller number here in my row groups. And I'm assuming it's because I have so many more files. You know, I have 361 files as opposed to 71 files. And it's just a ton of data. And like Phil said, I can switch over to SQL Endpoint if you don't want to write Python in a notebook. You can jump over to this Lakehouse, switch over to SQL Endpoint, and you can start writing queries against these tables to do some additional analysis of this table. It's amazing. If you're building lakehouses, if you're trying to figure out why your semantic models aren't running fast, go run this on top of it, and you'll get some good key indicators as to why your reports are slow. Anything you want to add, Phil?
I have been helping customers who are getting started with Direct Lake, and they want to know how they can make it faster. So I built this for me, selfishly, because it's the first thing I want to know is, okay, what's the state of the data in these files? And this gives me that information that we can then go, all right, let's run optimize, or let's do this other enhancement or change, and then study the effect that that has on two areas of performance. How long does it take to page data into memory, which is what we call transcoding, and the query speed, which also can be impacted by how data is organized in these Parquet row group and column details.
Well, thank you, Phil. Thanks, everyone, for watching. If you have any questions, comments, you know what to do. Post them in the comments below. If you want to know more about Fabric, there's probably a video flying over my head. And as always, from Adam,
Phil,
and myself, thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.